You know when that prodigal son came home? Have you noticed that he never even had time to confess his sins to his dad? His dad jumped up. He went against his culture because a grown man didn't run. And he ran to his son. And then he embarrassed him a little bit and he grabbed him and he hugged him. And he just held him and he kissed him. And then he started to restore him. He clothed him with a new jacket, the Bible says. New robe, a new jacket, which is identity. He gave him a ring on his finger. New shoes. It's interesting how sometimes when we experience things like this and God restore people, how those who were with him sometimes get jealous. It's not just a story that Jesus told. I see it practically sometimes unfold. And how people that was with the Lord all the time get jealous because of the restoration that they see in this person. Have you realized that not once did the Bible says that he squandered his money on the prostitutes? But his brother said that. It's nowhere in the story. But it was the perception of the brother, this is what my brother did. And it's like, I was with you all these times and you didn't even give me a fatted goat to celebrate with my friends. Here he comes back. Spend his money, spend his time with prostitutes, and now you give him a fatted calf. You celebrate with him. It's interesting what the dad said. He said, my son was dead, now he's back. And then he said, you, I had with me all the time. And then hear what he says. Everything that is mine is yours. And how we sometimes miss what we have because we focus on the lack. We perceive the lack which we don't really lack. That son perceived the lack which he never lacked. It was there with him. So I want to speak to you this morning about stolen identity. You might end a little bit different than normal. What's the first thing when you meet somebody that they ask you? What's your name? What's your name? Why would you ask somebody their name? You need to address them. It's part of identity. My son, Ivan, was on a cruise ship. And big cruise ships, but seven. When I asked him, he said to me, oh, well, it's six or seven stories. No, not a cruise ship, a yacht, big super yacht. And over December, old year, new year, there was a very well-known movie star on this yacht with her family. And my son was so impressed that she asked him his name. And she remembered it. And then old year's eve, she went to sit next to him. And she looked at him. Now her husband is next to him. And she looked at him. I think she just had fun with a youngster. She went to sit next to him and she asked him, so Ivan, have you had your old year's eve smooth yet? And he looked at him embarrassed. He's like, no. But he was so impressed that she remembered his name. See, there's something about a name that we address one another, but there's also identity linked to the name. But God calls us on our name. We're going to look at that. He sometimes changes our names because there's identity linked to it. And if I call you on your name, I acknowledge you for who you are. Anati, bani gamlaku. Anati. So what's the second question I ask you? What are you doing? Where are you from? What are you doing? And that's the one that I normally dodge when they ask me what I'm doing. Somehow we link identity to what a person does. What are you? I'm a teacher. So we link an identity to that person because that person is a teacher. I don't think it's bad. I think the problem is when we become that. Because when we lose that, we don't have an identity anymore. It's when we become what we do that we have a problem. See, it's a thing where money is not an issue. But if you are defined by money, there's a big problem. Because when do we think we are who we are because of finances? Not because I've got the same amount as you, because I've got more than you. And it's like, what's that? Shh. I'm it. And I start getting my identity from money. Or, as bad, when I define my identity because I've got less than you. And both are stolen identities. Because I put my trust, or not my trust, my identity in something that I can lose tomorrow. And I've seen that. And when I lose it, what do I have? What do I have? If my identity is in finances. Your identity can be in anything, in a car. I remember when I was a student, I had a motorbike that I loved. I loved it. I polished it nearly every day. And I remember one morning I woke up and God gave me a scripture. And the scripture didn't make sense. And a friend of mine came to me and he said to me, listen, I just want to go and draw money quickly. Can I use your bike? And I gave him the keys. My friend took a bit long to come back, and when he came back with a helmet in his hand. So, I learned quickly that thing became an idol in my life. And it was the first of many things that I lost. Not because I idolize it, but because we lose stuff in life. But when we lose stuff, what is the impact on your life? Do we lose identity when we lose stuff? Or is it, oh well. And of course there's sometimes a parting of. We need to be stewards. I'm not saying we shouldn't steward. We need to be stewards, and sometimes there are emotional things attached to stuff in a healthy way. And sometimes we need to part with stuff in a healthy way. I'm talking about stuff now. Eh? You understand what I'm saying? But the moment we lose identity, if we lost something, then it is like, wow, something was seriously wrong. And believe me, I loved my bike and I still love my bikes. But is our identity linked to that stuff? So, is your identity linked to what you do? Because I want to tell you today, you are more than what you do. Amen. You are more than your title. So when it comes to ministry, I don't understand when people are so sold on their titles. Because it's like, man, don't you understand you're more than your title? I mean, Paul teased the apostles. He was an apostle himself. But Paul would always write and he would say, he would always start a letter and say, I, Paul, comma, pause, breathe. That's what a comma is there for. I, Paul, comma, stop, breathe. A apostle of the Lord. Why? Because his identity was never formed because of the fact that he was an apostle. But he knew who he was in Christ. He never, if you can show me one place in Scripture where he put apostle before his name, I will repent. Because I've not found that, and definitely not in the Greek sentence construct. It's not there. He knew who he was in Christ. He knew his function, and that was that he was an apostle. But he also knew that that did not define his identity in Christ. Because we are more than just that. If you want to define yourself as prophet, you are more than a prophet. You bind yourself to an idea of who you are, because if God wants to move through you evangelistically, you're going to think in your mind, no, I'm a prophet, I can't do this. Yeah. You are more than your title. So I want you to keep what I said now in mind. Identity is a collection of attributes, beliefs, and experiences that shape how an individual perceives themselves and how they are perceived by others. It encompasses personal, social, and cultural components, often involving over time in psychologically, in sociologically, we create categories of aspects outlining the right. What is it saying?
Nothing.
It says that over time we get an idea about ourselves and we live according to it, and that's how people perceive ourselves. Which is not always the truth. I like this one more. Identity is the sense of self and the sense of worth. Because we all have a sense of worth. We all have a sense of self. If you don't have it, there's something wrong with you. And we all function from that place. And it's from that place where God spoke to Jesus and said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And right after that, he was led into the Holy, by the Holy Spirit into the desert. And the very thing that he was challenged on was what God spoke over his life. Where Satan would come and say, if you are the Son of God, come on man, you're hungry. Turn the stones into bread. Come on, show it. Show me. If you are. And it's that thing when we're not sure about who we are, we want to show who we are. I want to prove it. But because he knew who he was, he had no desire to prove who he was. He knew who he was. So we all need somebody to speak over something over us. The moment somebody calls your name, there's something positive that happens within you. Because we all need love. We all need acknowledgement. And we all need acceptance. But when we create our identity around that, then we've got a problem. But when we find ourselves in that, it's positive. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, in terms of IT or not only, mostly IT nowadays. How do you understand identity theft? Good. So, Facebook account hacked. Twinette's WhatsApp was hacked one day. And the person sent it like awful stuff. And her name linked to her WhatsApp. And so it's that somebody else is using your name for whatever purpose or using your name to gain from you. So they stole your identity. They took your identity upon them. Okay? So it's hacking, by hacking. Big business nowadays, social, the security in terms of anti-hacking and all that. And it, on Wednesday when we spoke, because I was walking with this, and on Wednesday we with family encounter, we started talking, and immediately my mind went to this, and I changed the message for today. There's something about spiritual identity theft as well. Where Satan steals our identity. Because if he can hack into your mind, he can control your life. So what's the first thing Scripture says after we got saved? We are a new creation. Everything has passed away. We are brand new. And then he says, now, you need to transform your mind to think according to the new person. Is that right? You need to transform your mindset because your mindset is so used to run on the old system. You need to run it on a new system, which is according to the true identity who you are in Christ. Now, God spoke to himself and said, let us make man. And then how did he say was he going to make man? In his image and likeness. And then God created man in his and he placed man and a woman that he created in his image and likeness in a garden, which was called Eden, which means delight. And he said to them, there you can eat of all the fruit and of all the trees you can eat. Except one. They were created in his image and likeness. They were given everything in a place of delight. And then the story starts. Now the serpent, the hacker, came. And he was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God made him. And he said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" Did you spot that? He never made a statement. He asked a question, but it was a very leading question into the wrong direction. And he challenged her mindset. She was created in the image and likeness of God, which is in fullness. They were placed in a place of delight. And he challenged her with lack. Where did her mind go? No. There's one I'm not allowed to eat of. There's one that I lack. The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you're not allowed to eat of it. No, he said, I'm allowed to eat of it, but he did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. He never said you're not allowed to touch it. So the moment she realized lack, perception started to kick in. See, and that's the problem, that when the moment the world starts telling us stories, we start to amplify the stories that we hear. The moment, and I love what Bill Johnson says, he says, the moment we believe the liar, we empower the lie. There's no power. Satan does not have power over us. But the moment we believe him, we empower him. And we believe and we empower the lie. So, and you must not touch it or you will die. And she becomes aware of the lack. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. What is he doing now? He is enforcing the idea of lack in her life. He's changing her identity of created in the fullness of God, created in his mind, in his image, and in his fullness, in a place of delight, and he's creating in her a new identity. And that is, you don't have everything. God is better than you. God has more than you. And he knows if you eat of this tree, you will have what he has. Is that true? That's what he said to her. And if you eat of it, your eyes will be open. And you will be equal with him. What was his challenge? Why was he kicked out of heaven? Because he wanted to be equal with God. He was so cunning that he took a third of the angels with him. And they were in the presence of God. He was so cunning. And now he's in front of a creation, a prime creation of God. And he's playing with her mind and he's hitting her on lack. And she realized, hang on. But there's something here, what he says makes sense. Sometimes there's difference between sense and truth. Sometimes things make sense to us, but it's not necessarily true. Your eyes will open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And that is totally opposite to what God said. It started with a question. It started with a leading question where the truth was twisted. But at the end, it's a blatant lie. When the woman saw the fruit of the tree, when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasure to... When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable from gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So it was not just Eve that ate us out of the garden. Adam helped her to eat us out of the garden. So the moment she saw what Satan showed her, things started to make sense. Doesn't mean it was truthful, but it started to make sense according to her new identity. The identity that was formed through understanding that I thought I had everything and now I have lack. I don't know everything. I want to know more. And in a moment she bought that lie, her eyes started perceiving things the way she never saw. I bet you that fruit never was appealing to her. She walked past that tree. Bible didn't say that, but I understand how our minds work. She walked past that tree how many times a day? And it never drew her. Till the whole lack thing was sold to her. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made covering for them. And then we know how division came between them and God. They started hiding away from Him. God went to search for them again. That's amazing, God. They were hiding away. It's like playing, I mean, He knows everything. And I said this so many times. It's like playing hide and seek with a 2-3-year-old. His bum is sticking out of the behind the couch. But for His sake, Pity Vasya, Pity Vasya, and you're looking for Pity, and where are you? But you can see his bum sticking out the couch. You want to tell me God didn't know where they were? When God asked people their names in the Bible, do you really want to tell me He didn't know what their names was? It was for their sake, for their understanding, for their identity that He asked them, tell me who you are. Tell me who you think you are. Tell me where you think you are now. Where are you? Go and look there. He asked the question, where are you? It's like, here I am. Why do you look different now? Why do you have leaves on? Like, no, we were naked. How do you know you were naked? Do you think God never knew that? Do you really think God never knew that they ate the fruit, they look different, they act different? Because they used to be in the coolness of the day, walk together in the garden, Scripture says. All of a sudden their whole attitude changed because their identity was stolen. And they ate that idea. They partook or partake of that idea. Now I want to challenge you with this. Jesus comes and He says, if you want life, eat my flesh. drink my blood. Woo, Lord, that's difficult. And they left. And then Jesus looked at his disciples, understanding church growth. He looked at them and said, do you also want to leave? And they said, Lord, where should we go? You alone have life. In you is life and spirit. And remember what he said, my words is life and spirit. What is he saying to them? Eat of who I am. Because if you eat of me, my identity will become your identity. What did Jesus taught them the whole time? I only do what I've seen my Father do. I only speak what I hear my Father speak. Because my identity is linked to my Father's identity. Then he went further and said that, you know what? If you reject me, you reject my dad. You cannot have my dad without having me. Why? Because your spiritual identity is directly linked to Christ. It's directly linked to Christ. It's in him that we are saved. That's why Jesus said, abide in me and you will bear much fruit. Didn't say you need to do anything. We just need to be in him. And then from that place, being in him, we will want to move. We will want to do stuff. But I don't get into him because of doing stuff. That's the thing what I love about God. He said that he loved us when we were still sinners. And now you're a child of him. He still loves you. So there was never a time in your life that he did not love you. But the moment you got saved, you stepped into your true identity. You stepped into Jesus. You stepped into righteousness. You stepped into a right standing before God in Christ Jesus. You stepped into fullness. And he placed you in a place of delight. Scripture says in Ephesians that he blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Why do we focus on the lack? Why do we focus on the lack? Why do we ask God to bless us if he already blessed us? I think there's a good mindset to acknowledge that our blessing comes from him. But if we ask to bless us because we think we are not blessed, then we have a problem. It is like children of God, who's got a sin mindset, that focus on sin, that see themselves as sinners. There's a problem. So I'm going to challenge you with this. Nowhere in the Bible a child of God is called a sinner. It is a title for a person outside Christ. But in Christ, we still do sin. But our identity is not formed around that anymore. I'm a child of God that make mistakes. But because we have a mindset of lack, and we think we are not holy enough, we go to the place of sin. And we do not repent from a place of repentance, but we repent from a place of not being good enough. Do you hear what I'm saying? There's a true thing about repentance. When we mess up, we need to repent. We ought to repent. But if we repent from a place of lack, there's a question over how we see our identity. It needs to be from a place of, man, I messed up. I'm sorry, Dad. Dad, I'm sorry. I'm going to quickly go to this. Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbed in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him, the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that? No, it's not what Scripture says. That they may have life. Oh, we're so self-absorbed that we may have life. You already have life. In Christ, you already have life. But there are people out there that does not have life yet. So he came so that they may have life. Who's they? Those who are not us, part of us. Those who are outside Christ. So Satan came to steal, destroy, and kill. But Jesus came that they might have life. And life in abundance. Don't check it out in your Bible. Do you all agree with your Bibles there, Peter? True life. That they may have life and have life in abundance. Some translations say true life is true. But that they may have it. There's more than just us. He wants to share it with the world. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd laid down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own knows me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. So, I want to do something a little bit different. Let's spend 5 minutes on this. I have to do it quicker than I wanted to do it. There's a couple of things Jesus mentioned here. He said, the sheep knows my name. He says, the sheep knows me, and I know the sheep, and I will give my life for the sheep. Okay. Isaiah 43 verse 1. Can you see there? Can you all see here? Isaiah 43 1 says, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. I called you by name. You are mine. So I want you just to sit, close your eyes, and tell yourself, He's got you. You don't have to fear. He knows your name. And you are His. Okay, the next one. Galatians 4 verse 9. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God. There's a difference to know somebody and to be known by somebody. He just not only know your name, you're not only His, you are known by Him. And that tells me it's a bit more intimate. So I just want you to close your eyes again and tell yourself, I am known by God. Do not go to the place of lack where you disqualify yourself because you're not good enough because of what you did and all that. Go to the place where you acknowledge that He knows you, that you are known by God. Revelation 2:17, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit of the says to the church. To the one who conquers, I will give one of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. God knows your name. But He's also going to give you a name that only you and Him will know. So close your eyes. Just thank the Lord that He knows you for who you are. He knows your name. He knows who you are. That you know Him. But that is also going to change your identity according to a new name. Where He names you according to who you are. Philippians 3 verse 20. Our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior. This is huge. When you go home, take out your ID. Right at the top, it says citizen of South Africa. And at the bottom, it asks a question, citizenship of South Africa. Your identity is more than an earthly identity. There's a heavenly citizenship linked to who you are. So I'm going to ask you again, close your eyes. Just thank the Lord that you are part of His kingdom. You are more than who you are. Thank you, Father. 1 Peter 2 verse 9. But you are a chosen race. Go and read this at home tonight. Meditate on this. If you're scared of the word meditation, go and contemplate on it. But you are a chosen race. A royal priesthood. A holy nation. A people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. Go and look at all those points identifying you to him. It's part of who your identity in Christ is. Once you were not a people, now you are God's people. Once you had no receiving mercy, but now you have received mercy. He's taking you from a place of lack, and he's showing you what you missed out on in the past, and he's showing you what you have now in Christ. Now, you can tell me, and I'm going to close with this. I know we're taking a bit long today. You can tell me and say, but Rudolf, this is a lot of abstract ideas. A citizen of heaven, I'm part of the heavens, and I'm a child of God. And all these things are very abstract ideas. A holy nation, a royal priesthood. But I want to challenge you with this last idea. This is not abstract. This is history. You can go and study it. Jesus did not just die on the cross. He died on the cross for you. This is not an abstract thought. There's enough proof that there was a man called Jesus that walked this earth. There's enough proof in history that a man called Jesus died on a cross because he was crucified. And if I link that historical fact to what my Bible says, then he must be the Son of God who died for you. Now, the Creator that created the universe by speaking a word is the one that loves you. Is the one that gave his Son to die for you so that you can have lived, so that you can live. It was Jesus that said, I know you by name. I know my sheep by name. My sheep knows me, and I know my sheep. When I call them, they will follow. And then he said, I will lay down my life for them. He laid his life down for you because he loved you. Why go to a place of lack? If God of the universe paid the full price, may he fill your heart. May he fill your spirit, because last week we heard that we are a spiritual being, a spirit being. May he fill your spirit this week. May he fill your mind this week. May he fill the lack that is always searching for more this week with the fact that you are truly a son of God. That you are a royal priesthood. Go and put all these titles down on your mirror. When you look yourself in the eyes that you can see those list of things who you are in Christ. May you become aware this week of who you are in Christ. May you become aware this week of who you are in Him and not the lack that you think you are. And may He take you this week from glory to glory in the likeness of Jesus. That likeness in Greek is icon. What do we have on our computers today? Icons. When you click on the icon, it takes you into that program. May you click on the icon Jesus. May you become the image of who He is. Because Scripture says we have the image of Christ. May He take you from glory to glory in the likeness, in the icon of Jesus Christ. Father, I thank You for every person that's sitting here today. Father, I pray that You will take us from a place of understanding and a place of agreeing with the enemy of how we lack to a place of fullness in You. Father, an understanding of what it is to have the fullness of Christ in us. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Father, the fullness of who Christ is within us, that we may be formed according to that. Father, I pray this week, every mind, dear, that You will take us this week on a journey acknowledging who we are in You. Starting to understand and starting to move into this fullness of who You are. Father, I also pray, Holy Spirit, that You will come and fill that place of lack in Jesus' mighty name. Father, if we found our identity in the identity of other people around us, I come and I pray that You will fill our identity in ourselves and with You. No longer bound to people around us, their opinions and their actions. Father, I pray that You will come and fill us with love and life in Jesus' name. Thank You that You created people around us to love us. But Father, I thank You that within You is perfect love and that You can fill us with love. That You will fill us. And we'll move away from the idea of lack of love. Pray that You will bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.